Okay, everybody, and welcome back to another episode of Porkins' Great Game. I am your host, Pierce Redman, and you can find this podcast by going to porkinspolicyreview.wordpress.com. And joining us, as always, is our co-host and Boiling Frogs Post contributor and the author of the new Great Game Roundup, which comes out every single week, is Christoph Gehrman. Christoph, how are you?
Hi, Pierce. Thanks. I'm fine. I'm excited for the first episode of 2015, and I think it's going to be an interesting year in Central Asia and the Caucasus region.
Absolutely. I have been looking forward to this podcast for a little while now, and it's going to be another jam-packed episode. So I think we'll just dive right into this because we've got a lot of interesting ground to cover. And for our first story that we're going to be looking at is something that I'm assuming the listeners are at least somewhat familiar with, and that was the December 4th attack in Grozny, in Chechnya. And this was carried out by several militants. It lasted several hours, a large gun battle with law enforcement. Somewhere in the neighborhood of 10 police were killed, 28 wounded. I believe 14 of the militants have also been killed, and a local media building was stormed and set on fire. And of course, as me and Christoph have been talking about on the podcast, this is another one of these sort of attacks that are designed to send a message to Putin. And of course, this recent attack took place just a few hours before Putin's State of the Nation address. Now, of course, Chechen authorities were very quick to assert that this was, carried out with at least the tacit support of the West and NATO, and I think we'll get into that in just a moment. But Christoph, do you want to just kind of flesh out the picture of what happened in Grozny, and then we'll start to get into some of the specifics of this?
Yes, sure. As we mentioned in an earlier episode of Porkins' Great Game, at the beginning of October, the Chechen capital Grozny was hit by a suicide bombing, which ended a period of relative calm in Chechnya, and the attack was most likely meant to send a message, as you mentioned. And then 2 months later, on the eve of Putin's State of the Nation address, Grozny was again attacked by a group of insurgents who seized three cabs and drove to Grozny, where they killed three traffic police at a checkpoint before entering the city. They then occupied the press house building and later also a nearby school, which were both heavily damaged during the ensuing fighting. The fighting was really intense and lasted several hours, and Chechen leader Ramzan Kadyrov, who was already in Moscow for Putin's speech, went out of his way to organize the anti-terrorist operation personally. He even negotiated with the insurgents, but the talks quickly turned into a bizarre theological argument and led nowhere. So the local security forces showed no mercy and eliminated all terrorists. After all was said and done, all 11 insurgents, 14 policemen and one civilian were dead, and more than 30 policemen were wounded. The clashes clearly overshadowed Putin's speech, and Western media and politicians could barely contain their joy. Former Swedish foreign minister, Russia hater and warmonger Carl Bildt used the opportunity to tweet a street battle in Grozny. Moscow should have more pressing priorities than destabilizing Ukraine. And since the clashes in Grozny embarrassed both Putin and the Chechen authorities, Kadyrov publicly apologized to the Russian president for the incident, but Putin assured him of his full support. And it's important to note that there are countless Russian forces in the region which could be called upon to intervene in such a case, but the Chechen authorities are given free rein, and they handled the situation once again to the satisfaction of the Kremlin. Kadyrov enjoys full Russian economic and political support to rule Chechnya in any way he sees fit. And this is important to restore the pride of the Chechen people. And the Chechens demonstrated this week that they are more than willing to repay the trust placed in them. But we'll get into that a little bit later. I think we should first talk about the two countries which were mentioned by Kadyrov in connection with the Grozny attack.
Absolutely. So, Kadyrov, of course, alleged, and I don't think that this would be much of a stretch, that the attack was financed and planned by Akhmat Umarov, who is the brother of Doku Umarov, who was the leader of the Chechen insurgents. And he said that this Umarov is of course in Turkey, and that this is where he is organizing these sort of attacks. But before we get into that, because that is of course a big story that we're going to unpack, I think first let's look at the other country which Kadyrov pointed to, and that is Ukraine, of all places. And Kadyrov called for a criminal case to be opened against several Ukrainian parliament members due to their vocal support of the Grozny attack. And we have one person, Igor Mosachuk, who was the head of the Azov battalion, saying that Ukraine should stimulate events similar to Grozny across the North Caucasus and Central Asia. And we had an even more insane claim was made by the People's Front deputy leader, where he said that the Ukrainian state had at one point spread as far as Grozny until the Russian Revolution in 1917, which is beyond insane. But Christoph, we believe it was in the last Porkins Great Game, we touched on this briefly, the sort of connections between certain elements of the far right in Ukraine and the Chechen militants and insurgents. So let's get into this, because there is actually quite a bit of history between the two groups, and this is actually quite a serious development. So why don't you break that down for us a little bit?
Yes, that's very interesting. In recent months, Ukrainian neo-Nazis, or as the Western media likes to call them, Ukrainian nationalists, have regularly spoken in high terms of Chechen jihadists and repeatedly called for terrorist attacks in Russia. And as you mentioned, Igor Mosachuk, who is a particularly nasty character, is one of them. He's the deputy commander of the infamous Azov battalion, and he has a long past in neo-Nazi organizations, starting with the Ukrainian National Assembly, Ukrainian People's Self-Defense, UNA und so, which was founded in the early 1990s and merged into the right sector last year. As some may recall, William Engdahl stated that veteran U.S. intelligence sources had told him that the Maidan snipers came from this paramilitary group. Mm. Whether or not that's true is anybody's guess, but the paramilitary wing of UNA und so has a long history of appearing in conflict areas. Wherever Washington needs more boots on the ground, they reportedly fought in Transnistria, Abkhazia, and Kosovo. And they also participated in the First Chechen War alongside the likes of Shamil Basayev and Ibn al-Khattab, the Chechen jihadists. Therefore, Russia launched a criminal case against UNA und so and some of its members, including Maidan leader Oleg Tyanibok and right sector leader Dmitry Yarosh, shortly after the putsch in Kiev, because Yarosh made headlines at the time with a post on social media in which he called on Chechen terrorist leader Doku Umarov, who was still living at the time, to use the opportunity and strike against Russia. Mm. After Russian media ran with the story, Yarosh insisted that his account had been hacked, but nobody can deny the long-standing ties between Ukrainian neo-Nazis and Chechen terrorists. And the Ukrainians usually make no secret of this. A few days after Russia launched a criminal case against three Ukrainian MPs in connection with the Grozny attack, Igor Mosachuk, whom we had mentioned earlier, responded with a video of himself shooting at a portrait of Ramzan Kadyrov and promising to help the so-called Chechen rebels. And just a few days ago, Mosachuk claimed that Ukrainian partisans are now working inside Russia, in particular Russia's Rostov region, which borders Ukraine. Mm.
Yeah, and I mean, again, this is not really a conspiracy theory. As we're pointing out, I mean, they're openly talking about this. And literally, I mean, within hours of the Grozny attack, we had several high-ranking Ukrainian officials saying that this was a great thing. And just to kind of hammer this home, there was a recent story that you were talking about in the New Great Game Roundup, where you mentioned the fact that a famous Chechen militant, Kasan Zakayev, who was instrumental in organizing the 2002 Moscow theater attack, which was a very large-scale, very big attack that happened there, he was arrested while trying to enter none other than Crimea He was coming in through Ukraine with a fake passport. And this story, of course, sort of flew under the radar. There was not a ton of reporting on this, even in the alternative media. But this really raises an interesting question. You know, Christoph, where has this guy been all this time? Apparently no one has been able to find him. And then he pops up in Ukraine, entering into Crimea. And of course, Crimea is home to a very large Turkic-speaking Muslim minority group, the Tatars. And there are many, not many, but there are certain elements within the Tatar community who have been talking about how they want to wage a jihad against Russia. And this has, of course, contributed to the very tight security state that Russia has created in Crimea. But what is going on exactly with the Zakayev and, you know, where has this guy been, Christoph?
That's a very good question, yes. Well, it's no secret that the Ukrainian regime supports terrorist attacks in Russia and that they have a strong connection to the Chechen jihadists. So it comes as no real surprise that Zakayev emerged in Ukraine trying to enter Crimea. And there have been speculations for a long time. I remember Pepe Escobar wrote about this shortly after the coup in Kiev, that the United States and its allies, especially Saudi Arabia, could try to stir up the Tatar population in Crimea to destabilize the Crimean Peninsula. So his arrest, trying to enter Crimea with fake passports from Ukraine, is really interesting.
And just again, I mean, it just sort of goes to highlight these very bizarre connections between, you know, neo-Nazis and Wahhabist jihadis, which is, I guess, you know, opposites attract, and the two of them are obviously in union about this, at least. But let's also go into the other country, which I mentioned earlier, that Kadyrov, you know, blamed for this attack, and that, of course, is Turkey, which is housing, presumably, under NATO protection, Akhmat Umarov, who is, of course, the brother of Doku Umarov and is the, you know, ostensible head or at least the public face of the Chechen separatist movement. Now, of course, there are many Chechen militants that are fighting on behalf of U.S. and NATO, and many of them are found periodically in Turkey. And, of course, Doku Umarov is not the only person of note who has, you know, been found in Turkey in recent years. We, of course, someone who we've talked about many times, our friend Yasin Al-Qadi, was recently in Turkey visiting with Erdogan's son. And last year, bin Laden's son-in-law, Abu Ghaith, was detained by Turkish authorities while he was in a five-star hotel and was extradited, supposedly to Kuwait, but was intercepted by the CIA and taken to Jordan. But Christoph, we wanted to touch on this, A, because the whole story of Chechens in Turkey and the you know, a certain type of Chechen operating in Turkey is something that really needs to be spoken of and explored. But you wrote a really interesting article recently for Boiling Frogs Post where you went into some of the very interesting Gladio B operatives who have been captured in Turkey just within the past couple of weeks. And particularly, we wanted to talk about Abd al-Baset Azzouz, and who was Ayman al-Zawahiri's man in Libya. And he was just captured in Turkey at a sort of resort area. So, Christoph, why don't you just explain what is going on right now and what you were talking about in your recent article?
Yes, that's all very, very interesting. Kadyrov mentioned immediately after the attack in Grozny that Akhmat Umarov had organized the attack. And since Umarov's living in Turkey at the moment, Kadyrov called on Russia's law enforcement agencies to demand Umarov's extradition from Turkey. He even went into some detail of how the attack had allegedly been organized, and he implicated not only Umarov, but also Western intelligence agencies and Igor Kalyapin, the head of a human rights group in Chechnya, who had criticized Kadyrov just a few days before. Mm. He had criticized Kadyrov's announcement that the families of terrorists who had carried out deadly attacks would be evicted from Chechnya and their homes raced down to the basement. And this is exactly what happened shortly after Kadyrov's announcement, drawing heavy criticism from human rights groups and Western media. Kalyapin, the head of the human rights group, was shortly thereafter pelted with eggs, and his group, the Committee to Prevent Torture, their office in Grozny was set on fire after a huge rally in the Chechen capital. Kadyrov's move to implicate Kalyapin in the attacks looks like an attempt to silence an annoying critic, but it's difficult to say whether Kalyapin and the Committee to Prevent Torture are really as innocent as they pretend to be. We know, of course, how NGOs are being used by Western intelligence, and Russian authorities have ample reason to be suspicious. For example, one of the partner organizations of Memorial, which is arguably one of the most influential NGOs in Russia, is the German Caucasian Society. And the German Caucasian Society looks very much like a front for Chechen terror operations. Its members include, among others, Said Kazanom Abu Muslimov and Ahmed Sakayev. We will put the links and show notes so people can check for themselves who these guys are. And we will also provide a link to an eye-opener report by James Corbett about Ahmed Sakayev, Chechen terror, and Turkey's role in all of this, which brings us back to Ahmad Umarov and the Grozny attack and the other Gladio B operatives. It comes as no real surprise that Umarov is currently living in Turkey, given the fact that Turkey has long been the main base for NATO's Chechen terror operations. The Russians know this, of course, full well, and Russian hit teams have assassinated quite a few Chechens in Turkey in recent years. As soon as some Chechen is killed in Turkey, everybody assumes that the Russians did it. And Sibel highlighted this also in her book, The Long Gladio, when two Gladio B operatives talk about how they are going to take out a few of their own Chechens in Turkey.
Yes.
Well, no longer useful, and how they are going to blame it on the FSB.
Mm-hmm.
And that's a really interesting thought. And it brings us to last year's assassination of a prominent Chechen in Ankara. His name is Medet Onlu, and he was an influential leader in Turkey's ethnic Caucasian community. He supported Chechen separatism. He even bought the unofficial title Honorary Consul of the Chechen Republic of Ichkeria. But he opposed the exploitation of Chechens in Syria. And when he was assassinated last year, most people, including me, blamed it on the Russians. And the Turkish authorities even arrested Turkish men who confessed to the murder, claiming that pro-Russian Chechens had told him to do so and had promised him a beautiful life in Ukraine. But according to Medet Onlu's lawyer, the testimony of the gunman is incoherent and dubious, and Onlu's lawyer and his family are convinced that the prominent Chechen was killed because he was an obstacle on the Jihadist highway to Syria, as they called it, and that the Turkish authorities are trying to cover up the murder. That's a really interesting story because it highlights a few interesting things about Turkey and the Chechen community in Turkey. It's important to note that many of the Chechens fighting in Syria didn't come from Russia, but from Turkey, Georgia, and other European countries. And as the nephew of the killed Chechen leader Onlu pointed out in an article, many Chechens in Turkey lack residence permits and live under constant risk of deportation. And therefore, they are very susceptible to blackmail-like pressure, and they were presented with two options by the Turkish authorities: go to Syria or face deportation. And now that Onlu has been killed, they won't have a hard time recruiting more Chechen fighters.
No.
I can only recommend reading the whole article because it goes in a bit into Turkey's role in supporting terrorism in Syria as well, and Russia. For example, the NGO Imkanda, which we briefly mentioned in previous episode, if I remember correctly, and Turkey's role in all of that's very interesting.
No, again, and when you're reading these articles where Kadyrov is saying that Ahmet Umarov is in Turkey, there's like no questioning whatsoever by the Western media. How is this man in Turkey? What is he doing there? Who is protecting him? While they may try to paint certain elements of the Chechen separatist movement as freedom fighters, no doubt they have been involved in some very, very brutal attacks. There was the famous incident at a school in Russia where, many people were killed. So, again, why is this man in Turkey? And furthermore, why is it that every major terrorist seems to be in Turkey at some point? And that, of course, brings us back. In your article, you go into a very interesting character who was just captured in Turkey. And like many people who get caught there, was sent to Jordan. And this is, of course, Abd al-Baset Azzouz. You talk about the connections that Azzouz has with Ayman al Zawahiri. Presumably, this man knew Ali Muhammad or was even trained by him. And he also.
Oh, this was Abu Anas Al-Liby.
Oh, yes. Okay. Well. of course, Azzouz and Al-Liby both lived in Manchester in England during the 1995-1996 period, where MI6 was protecting them and using the Libyan Islamic Fighting Group to try and assassinate Gaddafi. But Christoph, let's get into the recent capture of Azzouz, because his story is one that ties together a lot of the kind of Gladio B operatives and the sort of larger scale of what is going on in this global war on terror, in quotes there. What is going on with Azzouz right now, and why is this such an important story to be following?
Yes, the story of Azzouz is very similar to the story of other terrorists who have been captured in Turkey. For example, Salman Abu Ghaid, as you mentioned, Osama bin Laden's son-in-law, who was captured in Turkey last year, or yeah, the year before, I'm not quite sure. Azzouz was arrested in a summer resort south of Istanbul in mid-November. And if I remember correctly, as you mentioned, Abu Ghaid was arrested in a 5-star hotel in the heart, yes, of Ankara. And both times the CIA had provided the tip for the arrest. Very interesting. Just a few weeks prior to his arrest, the US State Department had added Azzouz to the list of specially designated global terrorists, which prompted the British press to publish a few articles about him, mentioning the fact that he had been arrested and detained, but then freed by the British authorities, which is, of course, the rule rather than the exception. Azzouz reportedly met Zawahiri in the early in the 1980s when he joined the Mujahideen in Afghanistan, and later on he moved to Britain and settled in Manchester, like many other members of the Libyan Islamic Fighting Group, which were supported by MI6, as you mentioned, to assassinate Gaddafi, which the plot which eventually failed. And after 9/11, the LIFG members were rebranded from freedom fighters to terrorists, and then back again when they were used to lead NATO's so-called Libyan revolution. Azzouz was one of the freedom fighters in Libya, and he was described as a key al-Qaeda operative, and he had reportedly been sent there by Zawahiri himself to coordinate al-Qaeda's operations in the country. And given that Zawahiri has been working for Western intelligence for decades, this all makes sense, but it doesn't have the official story of al-Qaeda. Interestingly, one of Azzouz's close associates in Libya was Abu Anas Al-Liby, the man with close ties to Gladio B operative Ali Mohammed, and also a very interesting past. The story of Abu Anas Al-Liby is very similar to the story of Azzouz, and I had written an article about him back in 2013 after he was captured, with lots of media coverage in the Libyan capital Tripoli, shortly after the Libyan revolution had brought the so-called Libyan rebels into power. Azzouz was snatched off the streets of Tripoli by US special forces and presented as one of the most dangerous terrorists, while his other buddies from the LIFG, like, for example, Abdel Hakim Belhaj or Mahdi al-Harati, were essentially running the country. Like the capture of Azzouz a few weeks ago, Al-Liby's capture didn't make much sense because they had both been doing the bidding of Washington all these years. But unfortunately, he can't tell us about it anymore because he passed away a few days ago, just prior to his trial. It's a really interesting pattern. These terrorists usually don't get to talk. Either they get tortured or drugged or they die.
And I think that this, again, this kind of goes back to a lot of the stuff that we've been discussing on the show recently, where we're starting to kind of see the official end of al-Qaeda and the rise of something different. Now, who knows if that is the quote Islamic State or, you know, another group like that. But it seems as if they are trying to kind of tie up the loose ends here. So we see al-Liby being captured, you know, probably tortured. Then he dies just a few days before his trial in a U.S. hospital, I believe, here in New York City, where I live. And I would assume that Azzouz is not going to make it to trial either. He will either disappear, or they will, you know, they will do something to sort of silence him. But again, this is sort of about sort of ending the Al-Qaeda chapter of Gladio B, and we're now entering into a new one. And again, much of this is shifting away, as we talked, I think, last podcast, from, you know, areas such as Pakistan into Turkey, which is becoming very similar to Pakistan in the 80s and 90s. Christoph, any other things that you want to touch upon in terms of Grozny or Chechnya? I mean, I know we're going to be returning to this again because, you know, as we said, I believe it was on the first podcast when we talked about the bombing in Grozny, that this is the beginning of something new. This is not going to, you know, this isn't just a blip on the radar. This is really the beginning of a new sort of campaign. So anything else that we should be looking out for?
Yes, we should probably mention that Brookings president Strobe Talbott made a prediction in his blog at Reuters that 2015 will see the outbreak of the Third Chechen War.
Mm. And Strobe Talbott, for anybody who's unaware, is a noted deep state actor. He was a high-ranking State Department official under Clinton. And while, you know, there are lots of, you know, NGOs out there that, you know, varying degrees of influence, Brookings is an extremely influential and powerful and, you know, foundation think tank. That when a man like Strobe Talbott, as you say, predicts that 2015 will be the beginning of the Third Chechen War, he's really announcing that 2015 will be the beginning of a possible Third Chechen War. So, so you know, again, we're going to be returning to this, but let's leave Grozny for a little bit and talk briefly about our next story, which is also has to do with Russia and again with Turkey, oddly enough. But this is, of course, the huge announcement that took place on December 1st of 2014, in which Vladimir Putin announced the end of the much lauded and extremely expensive natural gas pipeline, known as South Stream, which would have brought a massive amount of natural gas from Russia into Europe, eventually, I believe, ending in Austria and Italy. Now, of course, the major causes for the demise of South Stream have to do with what's going on in Ukraine. To a degree, the sort of sanctions that were being placed on Russia. But the main sort of you know, reason for much of this has to do with the United States and the EU pressure on several of the countries that this pipeline was going to be going through, particularly Bulgaria, which was told many times to stop construction on South Stream. Now, of course, both sides of the argument have been trying to kind of, you know, spin this positively. So, of course, we've got Russia claiming that everything is going to be fine. They have plans to continue South Stream, only instead of going, you know, directly into Europe, they will, they will change the pipeline route and they will go to Turkey instead. So Russia is claiming this is all okay. You know, gas will continue to flow, whereas the, you know, Western media and the EU and NATO are trumpeting this as proof that Russia's geopolitical actions have isolated it, and oh, you see, no one wants to work with them. Even though, of course, they are threatening Bulgaria with God only knows what if they were to allow this pipeline to go through. But, Christoph, this is a big story in terms of the scale. I mean, South Stream has been lauded, again, as this, you know, huge, huge development. But what's your initial takeaway from all of this? Because it seems as if you know, Russia did kind of lose out on this, and Turkey is positioning itself to be quite a powerful energy broker, you know, for Europe and the Western world. So what is your initial take on what happened with South Stream?
Yes, when Putin finally announced that South Stream won't be built, it came as no real surprise because some people have been saying for months that Brussels will do everything in its power to stop the construction of the pipeline. I remember back in last April, Ambrose Evans-Pritchard wrote an article for the Telegraph stating that South Stream is politically dead. That was 2 months before Putin and the Austrian president signed another deal on the pipeline, and many countries and companies involved in the project didn't believe that the project was dead at the time. But in the end, Brussels and Washington got their way after bullying several European countries, most prominently Bulgaria. They even threatened to topple the Bulgarian government if they don't stop the project, and John McCain and two other US senators flew to Sofia to convey the message to the Bulgarian government. That was really a symbolic moment signaling the end of South Stream and the end of European independence. Putin hit the nail on the head when he accused the EU of denying Bulgaria its sovereign rights and said that blocking the project is against Europe's economic interests. South Stream was aimed at taking Ukraine out of the picture because Ukraine has always been an unreliable transit country. And since Nabucco is dead and Europe is not allowed to import Iranian gas, some European countries pinned their hope on South Stream. But Brussels and Washington championed the projects of the Southern Gas Corridor, for example, the Trans-Anatolian Gas Pipeline and Trans-Adriatic Pipeline, which will transport gas from Azerbaijan to Europe. The problem is they don't have enough capacity and the construction is taking longer than expected. Therefore, some countries in Southeast Europe face now several years of uncertainty and they refuse to give up on the South Stream project, and they have recently called on the EU to reconsider its decision. It's a ridiculous situation. If European leaders were really serious about reducing dependence on Russian gas, they would screw the stupid Iranian sanctions and import gas from Iran. But they have completely sold out to Washington during the Ukraine crisis. It's really embarrassing to watch. The Russians did basically the right thing. They have realized that it doesn't make any sense to talk to the critters in Brussels, and they canceled South Stream and redirected the pipeline to Turkey. If the pipeline will be built is another question, because Turkey is definitely interested. They are trying to position themselves as the energy hub in the region. But the Trans-Anatolian pipeline, which is supported by Washington and Brussels, takes top priority. So we have, again, lots of talk about pipelines, but few things get actually done.
Yeah, which is, of course, every time we talk about pipeline politics, it's a lot of that. It's a lot of this back and forth. I mean, these are huge undertakings. And, of course, geopolitics and economics are always intimately linked together. As I was looking at this when we were discussing topics, I mean, it seems at the end of the day, Turkey is the big winner here and could emerge as a very powerful energy player. Let's also keep in mind here that Turkey has the upper hand with Russia. Obviously, Russia is desperate to try and build this, but of course, Turkey has all the bargaining power in this sort of plan. And again, Turkey is you mentioned, Christoph, that Ukraine has not been very reliable. Turkey very much wants to have the natural gas going there, but they, of course, then they want to sell it to the rest of Europe and presumably refine it into much better petroleum. And again, as you said, we've got the Trans-Anatolia pipeline, and that is certainly, big on NATO's agenda to get the gas out of Azerbaijan. And while we're talking about some of the pipeline politics, there's along the same lines as the Trans-Anatolia natural gas pipeline, Israel is desperately trying to convince Europe that they should back a pipeline that would go to Cyprus and later to Greece, while not mentioning that all of this gas is actually coming from Gaza, hence the naval blockade and the recent war over the summer. But one last thing I think that is important to point out, that for all of the sort of talk in much of the alternative media about how Russia is trying to sort of stop NATO imperialism in Syria, seemingly they are okay with selling a lot of natural gas to the biggest regional adversary of Assad right now, and that is, of course, Turkey. So, a lot of stuff going on. I'm sure we're going to be returning again and again to not only South Stream, but just the general sort of all of these different pipelines. But, Christoph, quickly, anything else that we should be looking out for in terms of the South Stream or new pipeline stuff?
Yes, I think it's not necessarily over, the whole South Stream story, because some countries in Southeast Europe will have problems to secure their energy supplies. Mm. And I think that Brussels has completely sold out to Washington and will try everything in its power to prevent any more dependence on Russian gas. But the question is if they have a choice. So we will have to keep an eye on this.
Mm. And I think it's important to note right there, Southeast Europe is extremely dependent on Russian gas. We're talking about Bulgaria, Hungary, Poland, a whole bunch of countries. And of course, Ukraine, which for all of its, fighting back and forth with Russia, is due to start importing natural gas again from Russia. So, this is said many times, but for better or worse, Europe, it does, has to rely on gas from Russia. It's obviously not willing to get it, as you said, from Iran. And this, these large scale projects like the one in Azerbaijan, let's see if those really get off the ground. But let's move on to our final segment here. And we're going to be moving again to Afghanistan, which we talked about last month on the podcast. We were talking about some of the stuff going on in Turkmenistan along the Afghan border. And just as a quick update, we were talking about the sort of tit-for-tat fighting going on between the Taliban and the Turkmen army. And we talked about how the Turkmenistan had, quote, invaded into Afghanistan. And just as an update, we have we were talking last time about the Faryab province, but in Jazan province, just to the east of Farbian, the Taliban has taken over the entire district of Kamyab, which is within Jazan province, and now share a border with Turkmenistan. And of course, the Turkmen government has responded by continuing to seize more and more land from the Afghans, which are extremely unhappy about this because all of the land they seem to be taking is agricultural. But not very far away in neighboring Tajikistan, we see a similar story being played out along the border with Afghanistan. Now, a lot of this has been happening in Kunduz province on the Tajik border, which has always been a hotspot for violence in Afghanistan. But on November 26th, the Taliban kidnapped 16 employees from the Sher Khan port, which is on the Panj River, which is seen as one of the sort of gateways to Central Asia from Afghanistan. And following that, on December 20th, it was reported that the Taliban had kidnapped 4 Tajik border guards in Kunduz, who apparently had entered into Afghanistan to cut down trees for firewood. Now, right now, there are negotiations underway between the Taliban and Tajikistan, but this, of course, kind of underscores the massive security problem that has been created in the region. And this, of course, fuels the claims made by Afghan officials that the NATO withdrawal is going to destroy Afghanistan. Recently, we had the head of the National Directorate of Security, Rahmatullah Nabil, saying that this is all of the violence is a direct cause from NATO leaving. And just a few days ago, Ashraf Ghani made his first televised appearance in the West on 60 Minutes, saying that the deadline should be reexamined and there shouldn't be this dogma about leaving. And, and he had this, he kept smiling throughout this interview. I'm not sure if you saw Christoph with Laura Logan, but he was sort of laughing the whole time. And he had this whole thing where he was saying that, don't ever threaten an Afghan with violence because we'll strike back. But NATO, do not leave whatsoever because, we're going to fall apart if you don't. But Christoph, what has been going on? How should we be interpreting what's going on the Tajik border? Because again, this is very similar to Turkmenistan, but the situation in Tajikistan, which is a country we haven't previously discussed on Porkins Great Game, is a little bit different, and the problem there could actually be much larger than what is going on along the border with Afghanistan and some of the other Central Asian countries. So what is happening here?
Yes, the interview you mentioned with Ashraf Ghani was very interesting. One thing that I wanted to mention is when he was asked if he had told Obama that to re-examine its timetable, Ghani responded saying, "President Obama knows me. We don't need to tell each other."
Yes, very interesting.
We mentioned this in a previous episode that Ghani is very much a man of Washington. Mm. But while US and NATO officials are happy about the new Afghan government and praise the great success of the ISAF mission, China and Russia are understandably concerned about the situation in Afghanistan. And China has been trying to restart the stalled peace talks, put forward a proposal for a peace and reconciliation forum. This was first reported by Reuters last November. And I think we touched upon this in our last episode. Mm-hmm. But at the time, it wasn't clear whether or not the Taliban had responded to the proposal. And according to reports in Afghan and Pakistani media last week, the Taliban actually sent a delegation to China last November to discuss the issue with the Chinese government. There were no details of how the talks went, but that's definitely an interesting development to keep an eye on. And meanwhile, the Russian government has been warning of the situation on the Tajik-Afghan border, where the Taliban and allied insurgents have been causing some trouble lately with the kidnappings you mentioned. These incidents highlight a problem that we have been seeing building over the past few months with all kinds of insurgents, not just Afghan Taliban, but also foreign fighters who operate often under the banner of the Islamic movement of Uzbekistan or splinter groups like Jamaat Ansarullah. They are massing in northern Afghanistan, especially in the places where the NATO-led forces have already left. This has led to Turkmenistan's invasion, and it's also becoming a problem for Tajikistan. Although the Taliban are not necessarily interested in invading other countries, many of the foreign fighters who come from Central Asia want to continue their fight in their home countries. This holds true for Central Asian fighters in the Middle East as well. Just this week, Radio Free Europe, Radio Liberty reported that Tajik ISIS fighters had asked al-Baghdadi for permission to go back to Tajikistan and fight with Jamaat Ansarullah against the infidels in Tajikistan. The wannabe caliph denied the request, and it's going to be difficult for these fighters to leave the Middle East.
Yes.
But there is apparently a desire to take the fight home. Mm. And the Central Asian fighters in northern Afghanistan are in a much better position to do so than the ISIS fighters in the Middle East. I think that they don't have enough fighters currently to challenge the Tajik regime. But interestingly, during a recent debate on Radio of Europe, Radio Liberty, about this issue, former U.S. ambassador to Uzbekistan, John Herbst, mentioned that the estimated several thousand IMU fighters could represent a tipping force in either Tajikistan or Kyrgyzstan. Honestly, I doubt that the IMU has several thousand fighters right now, but perhaps they will get more recruits in the future. It's interesting to note that some people in the region have been warning that the US and the UK could try to create an independent state from parts of Tajikistan and Afghanistan, specifically Tajikistan's Gorno-Badakhshan and Afghanistan's Badakhshan province. I talked about this in a previous interview with James Corbett after the head of a Tajik think tank had raised the issue, and we will put the links for the interview and for the stories in the show notes. So far, I haven't seen any evidence that they're actually trying to implement this project, but that doesn't mean they won't try it in the future. We haven't seen any progress on the East Turkestan project in China's Xinjiang region for a while now. So why not try something new and establish a greater Badakhshan right on China's doorstep?
Mm, yeah, which is, of course, just shares a border with Xinjiang. But I think, you know, this is important because while there is so much in the Western media about, 2015, this is the end of America's longest war, as we have been reporting on this podcast, it really isn't the end. This is just a new phase that is happening. And I I really do think that this is going to pop up again and again. And, you know, what's going on in Turkmenistan on the border, and especially in Tajikistan, this might be the beginning of a plan that is, you know, they're starting to formulate. And again, as you said, I mean, both the Russians and the Chinese have been, voicing their opinions on this. The Russian ambassador to Afghanistan, Zamir Kubilov, made a claim that might be a little overblown, but that there are about 4,000 to 5,000 militants in Afghanistan on the border with Tajikistan. And Russia has been promising to help, build up the Tajik army, military, and border control. China has agreed to a joint police operations between the two. But I think it's important to underscore, too, that Tajikistan is the poorest nation in Central Asia. It shares a massive border that is extremely porous with Afghanistan and is the major transshipment point for heroin that passes from Afghanistan into Tajikistan, on to Kyrgyzstan, and then on to Russia and Europe. So, there's a lot that is going on. And that recent debate on Radio Free Europe, Radio Liberty that you mentioned also had another interesting guest on that, and that was Professor and retired CIA operative Brian Glynn Williams, discussing some of this. And that sort of brings us to our final little story, where we try to kind of pick something in that is in the news that has to do with a sort of larger scale, global war on terror. And that is the beginning of what will become a very important trial here in America, and that is the trial against Dzhokhar Tsarnaev, who is alleged to, along with his brother Tamerlan Tsarnaev, to be behind the Boston Marathon bombing. And I mentioned Brian Glynn Williams because, like the entire Tsarnaev family, he knew, they all have connections to the CIA, and Brian Glynn Williams actually knew Dzhokhar Tsarnaev, who is appeared in court for the first time in like 2 years, I believe. And right now it is jury selection. There's not a whole lot for us to report on this, but I really do think that this is very important because, A, this is the, as they've been claiming, the largest terrorist attack since 9/11, but we haven't really seen how this story is going to entirely play out. We're not sure what the narrative that, they are going to be presenting to us. But again, important to note that Tamerlan and Dzhokhar Tsarnaev are from Dagestan. They are Chechen. Recently, Christoph, I know you pointed out in one of the New Great Game roundups that the head of the leaders of the Caucasus Emirate of the Dagestan Network have pledged their loyalty to the Islamic State. So again, there is that sort of element. They're trying to raise that in our minds. And there are other people who are on trial alongside Dzhokhar Tsarnaev, and almost all of them are from Central Asia. They're either from Kazakhstan or Kyrgyzstan. So again, they're linking in Central Asia here. But Christoph, do you have any thoughts or comments on the Tsarnaev trial, or any sort of things you want to point out?
Yes, I think the Boston Marathon bombing isn't really resolved. There are still so many unanswered questions and so many things which are left open, and it will be interesting to see if the trial will unearth any new information. For example, I remember last November, federal prosecutors admitted in a court filing that they have no evidence to suggest that Tamerlan Tsarnaev participated in the triple murder he had been accused of.
Yes.
Which is quite interesting, considering the killing of Ibrahim Todashev by the FBI.
Yes.
So I think we should keep a close eye on the trial, and it's going to be interesting to see how they're trying to link this to the developments, and if they're trying to link this, and if and how they're trying to link this to the developments in the Caucasus region.
Yeah, and I think that is the one of the main purposes of whatever this assuming that this is a Gladio operation, that this is some that it was some sort of deep state event. We are you know, possibly going to see some sort of link between those things. And again, we will definitely be returning to this on this podcast. But if anyone else is interested in a little bit more background and some really good, reliable reporting, I would definitely suggest whowhatwhy.com, which has been doing some of the best work on the Boston Marathon bombing and actually getting into all sorts of the odd stories, from the carjacking to this triple murder, which they have no evidence for, to the killing of Sean Collier, the MIT cop, for which there is actually no proof that the Tsarnaev brothers were involved in that. So we'll provide some links to some of the who, what, why stuff as well. But Christoph, it is 2015, and I know it seems a bit hokey, but you know, everyone gives predictions, you know, when we enter a new year. So I thought that we could do the same, and I guess we'll just we'll start with your predictions. What do you see for 2015 in terms of Central Asia, Caucasus, the global war on terror? What are your predictions?
I take the prediction of Brookings President Strobe Talbott very seriously, and I think that the United States and its allies will try to open a second front against Russia. Whether this will be in Central Asia or the Caucasus region, I'm not quite sure. They will probably try it in the Caucasus region, but they will have a really hard time. And I would like to point out a recent meeting in Grozny's stadium, where Ramzan Kadyrov gathered 20,000 Chechen volunteers who are ready to defend Russia wherever President Putin deems it necessary. Kadyrov said he knows that they have a regular army, air force, navy and nuclear forces, but there are problems which can be solved only by volunteers. He's of course referring to the volunteers who are also fighting in Ukraine. And when the Russians need plausible deniability, they will send these forces. So they will send them, for example, into Central Asia if the situation deteriorates there, or they will send them to Dagestan or Chechnya, wherever they are needed. Mm. So I think the Russians they know exactly what's coming in 2015, and they have been preparing for this.
Mm. Absolutely. I completely agree. And this is something that we had been saying when we first started the podcast, that this was going to become bigger. And now, of course, with Strobe Talbott's article in Reuters basically saying, yes, this is going to happen, I don't think we need much more proof. And my predictions for 2015 have to do with Afghanistan. I think that we're going to see a whole new set of conflicts going on in Afghanistan. And all of this talk about the withdrawal, about how we are ending America's longest war, is complete BS. You know, with every passing week, Obama adds more troops into you know, Afghanistan here and there, little bits. He opens up, you know, opens the door for drone strikes. We've got everyone in Afghanistan, every official, asking NATO not to leave. And we've got a very powerful resurgent Taliban. So I think that there are going to be some very interesting things going on in Afghanistan. And as we have been pointing out in the show, this is beginning to spill over into neighboring countries. So we're going to see perhaps a rise with terrorism within Central Asia as a whole. And one last prediction is I think this year we are going to see the beginning of a real rebranding of IS, the Islamic State, Daesh. I think they're going to start to really formulate where that is going, what the direction is that they want to go with. And as we pointed out many times on the show, Christoph, a lot of these fighters are coming from Central Asia. So, you know, I mean, they're going to return at some point. So, well, Christoph, anything else that you wanna point the listeners to? Anything that we should be looking out for the future, for the next podcast?
Perhaps we will also see the end of Ayman Al Zawahiri and
Yes, actually,
he's
great.
Very old,
yes.
And Al Qaeda is not really competing with ISIS anymore, so they will have to take him out at some point. maybe in a spectacular raid, maybe in a drone strike, who knows? But perhaps even in Turkey in a five-star hotel.
Ooh, yes, I had not even thought about that. But yes, I mean, Ayman Al Zawahiri is basically it. He is Al Qaeda now, and they are tying up all the other loose ends. So, you know, Ayman, if you're listening, watch out because they might be trying to come get you. But anyway, Christoph, excellent episode as always. And of course, we want to thank all the listeners who have been supporting the show the past couple of months. We've had tremendous feedback. This has been, you know, so enjoyable to do. And of course, if you are interested in listening to more of the podcast, then please go to porkinspolicyreview.wordpress.com. And you can also go to Christoph's website, which is newgreatgame.blogspot.com. Oh, excuse me. It is christophgehrman.blogspot.com. It's been a little rusty today for me. And of course, if you really want to get the inside view on all of this stuff in Central Asia, in the Caucasus region, the global war on terror, then there is no better source than Christoph's weekly series of the New Great Game Roundup. And Christoph, where can the listeners go to hear that?
Of course, they can always find it on my blog, as you mentioned, at christophgehrman.blogspot.com or on Boiling Frogs Post, where you can always find my other articles as well.
Yes, excellent. And Christoph, you have been writing a couple new articles, and we'll be including all of those. And everything that you write is definitely worth looking at, as you provide so much great information. So I think we're going to leave it there. Again, if you want to, send us some suggestions, you can always email us, and always follow both of us on Twitter. You can follow me at Porkins Policy, and you can follow Christoph at New Great Game. So we're going to leave you there. Christoph, as always, thank you so much for joining us on the show.
Thanks, Piers.